How you doing? Hey, let's pray in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Better be allowed. Amen?
Amen.
Gracious God, we thank you so much for this afternoon, and we just pray nothing less than the fullness of the Holy Spirit to come to this place, be our teacher, be our guide, open us up to the goodness and the mercy that you have in store for us. And we ask these things in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks, you guys. Have a seat. Have a seat. What a treat. High five the person next to you. Say, are you awake? Yeah. Yeah. If you just smacked him in the head, apologize. That's good. That's good. So, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I'm a dad of five daughters. I actually have three of them are teenagers. Yeah, only two bathrooms, so pray for us. There's a lot of problems there. And they're all beautiful, they're all incredible, independent, amazing women. And when our fifth was born, she was born with Down syndrome. Down syndrome is a genetic condition, the 21st chromosome. She's rocking an extra chromosome. She was born with all kinds of challenges. A valve in her heart didn't close all the way, and so blood was not pumping to her brain the way that it was supposed to. And it was kind of crazy. You moms that have delivered babies, you know, by the time you get to that fifth kid, you're in the delivery room, and there's a lot going on, but you're kind of in control. It's like, hey, I want this, I want that. And us husbands, we have no role whatsoever, right? Our job in the delivery room is to be like, just give her whatever she wants. Just whatever she wants. Just do it. Drugs? Give her drugs. Just give her the drugs. Doesn't matter. And so it was pretty stressful when this beautiful little special needs baby was born, and we didn't know that she had Down syndrome. And the cord was wrapped around her, and I didn't get to cut the cord. And right away, she was kind of whisked away from my wife. So you moms know that touch at the very, very beginning is super important. My wife didn't get that. And they kind of whisked her over, and they were putting little needles in her and kind of getting her to be awake and started hand pumping oxygen to this beautiful little girl. And then they just kind of rolled her out of the room. And we were just standing around like, what is going on, right? What's the deal? And this doctor, who did not have the best bedside manner, she walks in and she just says, we have to do open-heart surgery on your newborn. We're going to fly her to Seattle. We'll let you know when we get there. And I was like, what? And I looked over at my wife, and she was just in panic. And she looked at me like, what? And I had to go run out and get the doctor and just be like, what are you talking about? And you need to give me more details. And I finally go back to my wife, and my wife is just weeping. And she is like, what is going on? And I reached in, and I prayed with her, and we just sat there, and we were like, I don't know what this means. I don't know what special needs means. We have no idea. Let's just pray that she's okay. This other doctor walks in and says, hold the phone. We're not flying her anywhere. I've seen this before. We're going to wait it out. We're going to wait it out. Everything is stable. We're going to wait it out. And I look over at my wife, and out of sheer exhaustion, my beautiful wife, Becky, she just absolutely passes out. She's just like, and she's asleep, right? Now, I had 50 cups of coffee at this point. It was 4 o'clock in the morning. Now, if you know me, that's really only about 2 more cups than I usually have. So that's really not that big of a deal. And I kind of jumped up, and I'm like, oh, man, we got to do something. And I go out in the hallway, and I'm like, we got to baptize this baby. Like, we got to baptize this baby now. Now, one of the benefits of being in church work for a long time is that I have a lot of priests on speed dial, right? 4:15 in the morning, grab my phone. A, B, 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 Bishop George Leo Thomas, the Bishop of Las Vegas. Anybody Las Vegas here? Yeah. He used to be my bishop. Yeah, he was my boss. Worst thing he ever did was give me a cell phone number, right? So I called him. I called him at 4:15 in the morning, and the message was something like, hey, Bishop Thomas, Doug Tooke, I really need you right now to be a priest. I need you to come to the hospital, Down syndrome, baby, baptism, something like that, okay? So then I get to CCC, the chancellor, Father John Robertson, and I get all the way to M. I don't know how many people I called, right? And I get a hold of Father Mark Linneman. Now, Father Mark Linneman is this very fit, handsome priest who at 4:48 in the morning happened to be out jogging, okay? I know. And he's not just jogging, I mind you. He was jogging with like a black fanny pack on where he kept his 2001 flip phone, okay? The year was 2011. 2001 flip phone, right? He answers his flip phone, which I swear like runs on diesel and has like a pole starter, okay? He's like, Doug, I've been thinking about you. And I'm like, Father Mark, baby, baptism, I need you now. And I kid you not, this is how he responds. He goes, I'm on my way. And he puts the phone away. Only he didn't go back and get his car. He just kept running from right there. And he shows up at the hospital, and I'm in the hallway, and he is just gross. He is like sweaty, disgusting priest, right? And he walks up to me. I'm not making this up. He was wearing a black Under Armour shirt with black Adidas shorts and a white stripe down the side. It was like priest jogging garb 101, right? And he looks at me and he goes, let's do this. And I'm like, okay, you know, and we go in the NICU and we wash our hands and our feet and our head and everything. And we're putting on all the green stuff. And I look over and like 15 feet away, that same nurse is hand pumping oxygen to my little girl. And she looks up and she just goes, which one of you is the father? And we both go, I am. And we just walk over to her. This nurse is pumping oxygen. And Father Mark just reaches in and puts his hands right on my little girl. I mean, there's tubes everywhere. She has like a plastic hood over her. And the nurse kind of looks at him like, sir, you can't do that. And Father just looks up and he goes, ma'am, I'm gonna. And he just leans in. And he goes, hey, do you want to baptize? I'm like, I don't know. Everything's stable. I don't know what to do. And he goes, well, I'm going to anoint her no matter what. And I didn't know if you could anoint before you baptize. But I asked a bishop, and he said yes. So if you have a problem with it, you can take it up with him. All right? Father Mark reaches into his fanny pack and pulls out an anointing kit that he happened to have while jogging. Who are these people, right? And he just goes for it. He's saying the prayers. She smells like perfume. He's got his hand on her, his hand on me. We're praying. It's gorgeous. And I look up, and this nurse has lost it. She is weeping, and she's just looking at us, and she just keeps going, what's going on? What's going on? Who are you people? Why are you smearing that on her face? What? And she's talking under her breath because she can't handle it. She just can't handle this moment, right? And it's beautiful, right? And Father Mark looks at me and he just goes, hey, man. He goes, hey, we're good here. Why don't you go check on Becky? I'm like, okay. And as I'm leaving, this nurse asks Father Mark, says, what are you doing? And he just looks at her and smiles, beautiful smile. And he says, I just anointed her. And let me tell you about what that means. And he just unpacks like this sacramental history as I'm walking away, right? Gorgeous witness to this incredible nurse, right? So I take all the stuff off and I go across the hall and I open the door to check on my wife, and there's the bishop, the chancellor, and four other priests standing around her. Now listen, you ladies, this woman had given birth like an hour and a half ago, okay? So she is like under the covers, right? Her hair is six ways from Sunday, okay? She's got like blotchy skin. She looks over at me like this, she's like. And the bishop is holding her hand, the chancellor's holding her foot, and the other guys are just standing over her like this. And the bishop looks up at me, Bishop Thomas, your incredible bishop, who's a wonderful man. He looks up at me, and I look at him, and he goes like this. He goes, hey, Doug, we're good here. And I go out in the hallway, and I'm completely useless. And it was the greatest uselessness of my life. And here's what I learned. I've seen beauty before. I've seen beauty before. I have daughters. They're beautiful. I travel the country. It's really beautiful. There's a lot of beautiful people. Some of you are pretty ugly, but most of you are really pretty. You're really beautiful. I've seen beauty, and I thought to myself, how is this level of grace possible? We all have a story. We all have our own story, and here's what I love about ministry is ministry is really a collection of stories. I work in the movie business. We tell stories, and I love stories, and if we had time, we could get together and we could share our stories, and our stories really make up who we are, but that's not the sum total of who we are. And if we get stuck there, it becomes a problem. Sarah just referenced that super well. Like it's not just about us, right? There's another story. There's another story. The church's story, the bride of Christ, the birthday of the church's Pentecost. The church was born in the name of the Holy Spirit on a day where cultural, ethnic diversity and multiple languages thrust into the streets and proclaimed the salvation of Jesus. And people were converted. And we know from history, this isn't mythology, this is real. We know that John, with our mother Mary, went
to Ephesus, Paul's letter to the Ephesians, and he was eventually arrested and sent to the island of Patmos. We know that Thomas was sent to India. We know that one of the Jameses stayed in Jerusalem and actually ended up being the first martyred apostle. The first martyr was Stephen, but the first martyred apostle was James. We know that the other James went all the way to Spain. We know that Paul and Peter converged on Rome. We know that the church grew and five major cities emerged: Rome, Jerusalem, Antioch, Alexandria, and Constantinople. We know that in Antioch, the word Christian was first used, that the first generation of people that were evangelized by the 12 became the patristic fathers of the faith: Ignatius of Antioch, Clement of Alexandria. And by the 3rd century, through the persecution, the Edict of Milan, and Constantine becomes emperor, and his mom, St. Helena, pilgrimages to the cross, and monasticism grows, and there's really good popes, and there's really bad popes, and then there's the Crusades, and then there's St. Francis of Assisi, and then there's Thomas Aquinas, and then the Reformation, and then the Counter-Reformation, then the Council of Trent, then the First Vatican Council, and then the Second Vatican Council, and then Youth Day LA. That's the church, okay? Now listen, that's a good story. It comes from the table. It was born of ethnic diversity and language. Beautiful. But that's just one other story. And guess what? Your story, right, is supposed to converge with that story. It's supposed to be mingled. It's dangerous when we only talk about self, but this story, the church story, isn't perfect. It's laden with tons of humanity and brokenness. Thank God for God. Thank God the Holy Spirit is there, because on our own, we would mess that thing up. But that's not the only story. There's another story. It's called the story, and it's God's story, the story of God who was, is, and ever will be story. It's the God who's managing 15 billion known light years of space and knows how many hairs are on your head and knows your name story. And the only way that you can know that story is through Scripture. The only way, Catholics, that you can get to know the all-powerful Creator God is to stick your head in the Word and begin to make it a part of your life. And let me tell you something. I love VeggieTales, but VeggieTales isn't going to cut it. Catholics, you have got to make this a part of your life. Listen, you have phones. There's 1,000 Catholic apps. You can have the readings read to you. You literally don't have an excuse. There's a little Catholic guilt for you as you leave today, okay? You don't have an excuse. You are baptized to know all three stories. Your story is important. My story is formed by my incredible relationships with people, my incredible children, my beautiful wife. That's part of my story. It's not yours. You have your own. But that can become known through the church's story, but only truly known through the story, and that's what makes the lens for us to see the way God sees us. Ignorance of Scripture is ignorance of Christ. You will not know this vision without all three. Friends, this has to change. It has to change. When God sees us, He sees us through His story and the church's story and our story, and we have got to do a better job of this. Guys, when Jesus calls the first four disciples, Matthew 4, Peter, Andrew, James, John, they're fishing, you've heard it before. In Scripture, it says that Jesus saw them. Jesus saw them. He saw them working. He saw them doing their thing, doing their story. That's what He saw. And the word that's used is a Greek word, it's eidēn, and that word means to see with the mind. So what Scripture is saying is that the Creator of the universe, who is Christ, saw them with His heart and His mind before He ever used His eyes. And then there's actually nowhere in that passage where it says that He said, follow Me. It's actually an adverb, and the adverb is this, it's, hey, come on Me. It's not, oh, I was just wondering if you have time, if you could stop throwing your nets and follow Me. That's not what happened. It's, hey, now, on Me. He is demanding a close, intimate relationship from the beginning. Welcome to baptism. He's immediately grabbing your story and saying, ah, be a part of My story. It's way bigger. See the way I see. See through God's eyes. It's powerful. And we're supposed to do something with that. We're not supposed to be prophets like Jonah, where we just can't stand that God loves our enemies and we just rebel against them all the time. But even if you are, the Lord can use that, right? You try to run in the ocean and go the opposite way. He's like, no, I'm going to chuck you in the belly of a fish. And even in the belly of a fish, he shows mercy, right? There was only two ways out of that fish. He got the merciful way out, people. Don't kid yourself. Don't be like that. Be like Elisha. When Elijah's time comes to an end, and Elijah bestows blessings on Elisha, who would follow in his footsteps, Elisha looks at Elijah and says, this is not going to go well. I am not good at this. I need you to give me a double portion of your blessing. I need more blessings than you can possibly imagine. And Elijah does it, and the Lord does it. And Elisha becomes this profound prophet. The king of Syria is attacking the king of Jerusalem. And every time the king of Syria moves to attack, his plans are spoiled. And so he goes to his lieutenants and he's like, hey man, what's the deal? Like, they always know where we're coming. And they're like, it's the prophet Elisha, man. He's so dialed into God, he just tells him what's going to happen because he already knows. So the king of Syria gets ticked and he sends all these soldiers to kill Elisha. And Elisha's snoozing at his house and his servant wakes up and he sees all these Syrian soldiers coming to their house to kill him. And this servant jumps up, he's like, oh no, run. And Elisha's like, stop, look. And the Lord opens his eyes so that he can see the way Elisha sees. And all of a sudden behind Elisha, the hillside is covered with angels and chariots of fire standing to defend Elisha. And the servant goes, oh. And then Elisha walks the entire battalion of soldiers 12 miles to Samaria to the king of Jerusalem. And the king of Jerusalem is like, what are you doing? Should we attack them? And Elisha says, no. He says, feed them. He says, give them your hospitality and your love. And they do. And all the Syrian soldiers drop their weapons and they walk away. That's the kind of prophet we're supposed to be. Do you walk with the confidence that behind you is the guardian of heaven defending who you are? Or do you stand there like, I don't know what I'm doing. I just sort of live in my face and I have no idea. That's not enough. It's not good enough. We say a prayer at Mass, Lord, I am not worthy that you can enter, that you may enter under my roof, but only say the words and my soul shall be healed. Matthew 8, that's the worthy that we pray. And here's what happens. We come to conferences like this and we yap about Jesus and we tell you how beautiful you are and how good you are. And we respond as humans as, I'm not worthy. That has to stop. Let me tell you why. When you hear the word worthy in Mass, Matthew 8, the centurion's servant is saying the word ikonos. Ikonos in Greek means fit. What he's saying to Jesus is, Jesus, I am not fit to heal my servant. And guess what? That's correct. By yourself, you are not fit to go heal servants. You're not. It's true. With Jesus, yes. Without, no. And Jesus says, oh my gosh, you are spot on. Bless this man's faith. Look at what's going on. But guess what? In Matthew 22, and the guests were brought to the banquet table, and they were found to not be worthy. And the host sent out his servants to the streets to gather the broken, the poor, and the lame. That's us, by the way. And they were found to be worthy at the table of the Lord. And the use of that word worthy is axios, which means suitable. You were built to be at the table. This table that you're going to celebrate Mass at in a little while, you were made to be there. Axios is the root of the word axiom, which means an unprovable truth. It's a truth that needs no proof. It just is. It is an undisputable fact that you were made to be at that table. Stop acting like you're not worthy to be there. It's what you were made for. Friends, here's the deal. You're supposed to come to the table. And you're supposed to be the monstrance, the great demonstration of the precious body. What's the difference between you and in about half an hour when you walk up here and you say amen, and your bishop puts the body of Christ in your hand and you say amen and take it into your body? What's the difference between you and a monstrance? Nothing. Monstrances are really pretty, but we've already covered that. Some of you are really pretty, but it's okay. You can be an ugly monstrance. They exist. Look at this face. I got a face for radio. Don't kid yourself. This is the mission. The mission isn't to just be famous and be yourself. The mission is to align the stories because of Eucharist and to be the ultimate demonstration. I work for a film company called ODB Films. We've made a bunch of films. We made a film this last fall about a woman named Connie McEldowney. She's amazing. It's a gal about my age. She had 5 kids of her own, raised her family in Roussia, Ohio. One day she was with her church group and they went to a Planned Parenthood and they were praying out in front of Planned Parenthood for all the women that were going in to have abortions. And she just watched women walk in with black hooded sweatshirts. And as they walked in, they take away their phone and they take away their purse because you're not allowed to communicate once you're in there. And Connie had this moment of like fear. She thought, oh my gosh, these young women look like me. They look like my friends. They look like my niece. They look like my goddaughter. And she kind of broke down and she thought to herself, they think this is the best option. And she got really sad and really mad. And she went to her car and she grabbed her rosary off the rearview mirror and she just started praying. And she came up with a prayer that changed her life. She said, Lord Jesus Christ, use me. Use me to be a better option. I don't know what that means. Please use me. And she went home. And she went to her house and she noticed that a couple of her kids weren't using the space in their home that they used to use. And she reshuffled where they were living. And she kind of rearranged a couple of bedrooms, small house, 4-bedroom, 3-bath. And then she went to her husband and said, I'd like to invite people to live with us. I'd like to invite young women who are contemplating an abortion, who have children that need a safe place to live. I'd like them to live with us so that we can help them carry their baby to full term and we will help care for their children. And her husband was like, that's a crazy idea. And she said, yes, but I'm the mom and I'm in charge, so we're going to do it. And she did. And she invited one person and then another person. And then people kind of caught on to what she was doing and they started donating like diapers and formula and toys for kids. And they filled up their garage. And 4 women started living with them while she also managed her 4 other children that were still at home. And she went to her husband and said, we need a place to put all this stuff. We don't have room for all this stuff. And the community rallied around her and they donated money and they built a store that's open 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. every day where diapers and baby clothes and toys are free for any woman that needs them for her family. She called the ministry Rustic Hope. She serves 400 women per month because she had the courage to say, use me. Now listen to me. You can give her a round of applause. Connie McEldowney, Rustic Hope. I dare you. I dare you, young people. I dare you. I dare you to pray, use me. I dare you. I dare you today at Mass to just behold the beauty and just authentically pray, all right, Lord, use me. Use me to do your will. Not worry about the holiness in the next 10 years. Worry about your holiness in the next 10 minutes. Connie says, she says, how many times do we pray for people when we realize we're supposed to be the answer to their prayers? You can only get to that level of holiness when you authentically can say to Jesus Christ, use me. Use me to do your will. That's the mission. That's it. My little girl, my little Gwendolyn, last spring, she turned 9 years old a couple weeks ago. Last spring, she celebrated her first communion. It was awesome. If you've ever been to a special needs first communion, oh my gosh, your mind will be blown. And when you're the parent of a special needs child, there's just cognitive things that you know she's not going to get, right? There's just things she's not going to get. It's hard. She just doesn't learn the same way that we learn. And I'm such a youth minister. I was so worried about this. I just remember thinking, oh man, she's going to walk up there. She's not going to understand what this is. It's going to be like a snack to her. She just doesn't know. And I remember the night before, we had done all this formation. And the night before, I could not sleep. I was so nervous. I was just laying there with my wife. And I'm like, oh, this is going to go so bad. There's all this family there. And I thought, I just want her to know. This is him. This is the story. This is the creator. This is the one whose lens changes creation. This is the way the Lord sees us as vessels for his precious body. On me, he says. And I just want her to know that the creator has come to be with her. And she to say amen to that. And then I thought to myself, you're an idiot. Most of the people in this room don't even realize that. What are you really praying for? I just want it to be sacred. So she stood up at Mass the next morning. And don't kid yourself, I elbowed some moms in the forehead to get the photo, right? Moved over to the side. My wife stood up behind her, walked up behind her. She walked to the front. She was the first one out of like 25 kids. She put her hands out. Father Dan Shea said, "Body of Christ." And she very clearly said, "Amen." And she took it into her body. And I snapped a photo, and then I looked up, and no one was moving. My brother-in-law, her uncle, was playing guitar, and he stopped. And I looked behind him, and all these moms and kids were standing there holding their kids, and they were looking, and they were just watching. They were just watching her, right? Because it was the most beautiful thing they've ever seen. Everything stopped. It was so beautiful. People didn't know what to do with themselves. And I don't care what you think about clapping at Mass. People started clapping. It was awesome. The priest had to be like, "Okay, carry on, people. We got 20 more. Here we go." But then came the cup. And you parents of First Communion kids, right? The cup, that's when things can go poorly, right? Right? Sometimes an 8-year-old takes the blood and goes, right? But she didn't, because she's Irish. She went right up there. Deacon Steve Barry leaned down, held the cup, and she said, "Amen." And she took that into her body, and she smiled. And she sat down, and she crossed her hands, and the whole room looked at her. And I thought, oh, that's what we're supposed to be. That's it. You want to see the world the way that God sees you? I assure you, it's not about the photos of yourself that you take. It's about beauty, unobstructed beauty that will change the hearts of others. It's about Father Mark beautifully proclaiming the history of anointing. It's about men jumping up in the middle of the morning to comfort a woman. It's about a woman saying yes to a prayer that led to nothing short than daily conversion. Use me. That same priest, Father Mark Linneman, he was in Rome when St. John Paul II passed away. He was at the NAC going to seminary. And he wanted to see the smoke come out of the spires. He wanted to see the naming of a new pope. What a historical moment, right? So he cut class from the Gregorian University, and he ran all the way to St. Peter's Basilica. And he was there. He saw the smoke, and it was amazing. And then he ran all the way back to class, and there was a little nun, a little 29-year-old Filipino nun that was taking classes, Sister Dorothy. Always in her habit, always in white tennis shoes, and she was always carrying this really big backpack. So she looked hilarious whenever she moved around. But she was more obedient than Father Mark. She was just like, "What was it like?" And he said, "It was gorgeous. I saw history." And she just looked at him and she goes, "I have to go." And she jumped up and she ran out of the classroom and she started running in tennis shoes, right? Through the streets of Rome. Filipino nun running. And she gets to this sidewalk. And there's these 6 male tourists, and they're all drinking in the middle of the day. They got like brown bags around bottles, and they're just drinking, and they're about halfway there. And she's getting ready to go, and she's a pretty funny sight. And these guys start making fun of her, like, "What the hell are you doing? What do you think you're doing?" You know, totally making fun of her. And she just looks over with a big smile on her face, and she goes, "I'm going to see the new pope." And one of them goes, "What's a pope?" And she goes, "What?" And she walks down to him, and she goes, "Follow me." And then she turns and starts running. And 6 Norwegians start running after her. And they go all the way to St. Peter's Square. And she just loves them. She just huddles them around. And she looks, and if you've ever been there, she looks up and she points to all the saints. And she's just like, "That's that. And that's so-and-so. And this is what this is. And this is why this is. And isn't this beautiful? And this is why we're here." And these men are just like, "I don't know how to process this beauty. I don't know what happened, but I know that she had the courage to say, follow me." A good friend of mine, Father Nathan Scheidecker, newly ordained priest last spring, he was saying daily Mass this last fall at the St. Helena Cathedral. Big, pretty cathedral if you've ever been. And he's at the high altar, daily Mass. And you know how cathedrals are. There's kind of the narthex on each side, right? So there's like a door here and a door there, people sitting on the side. And that's where most people were sitting. And in the middle, right before the Eucharistic prayer, a Jimmy John's delivery boy walked into the church holding a bag of sandwiches. And this man had no idea what was going on. He had never been in a church his entire life. Not only had he never been in a church, he didn't even know what church was. Jimmy John's delivery, what's your job? Deliver sandwiches. So he just walks up to this woman who's praying and he goes, hey, did you order sandwiches? And this woman looks at him like, I will pray that a lightning bolt strikes your forehead immediately if you do not get away from me, right? Just total awkwardness. This guy goes to another guy and he goes, hey, did you order some sandwiches? And the guy's like, sit down. And then he looks up and he sees a table, right? And he sees a man standing at the table and he thinks, well, that must be where the sandwiches go. So he starts walking towards the altar. And this knight of Columbus, like, jumps up. I wish we would give him their swords back, right? He's just like, stop! I'll show you where to go! And he walks them out all the way around to the Faith Formation building where the secretary is standing with $22 waiting for her sandwiches. Guys, this is our reality. You think people are just not going to Mass because they don't know what, they don't care? There's a generation of people who have no idea what this mystery even is, why this relationship even exists, how these stories are supposed to align. They don't know. They don't know the beauty. They don't know that it's about their story and the church's story and the story. They don't know about praying, use me. They don't know about surrendering to be a vessel for Eucharist, to be a monster. They don't know because you and I don't tell them. That's our mission. You want to see the world the way God sees us? That's how you do it. Oh, and by the way, you're not fit to do it by yourself, but you're suited to do it with Christ inside of you. So that's got to be our prayer, right? No more of this laziness. No more of it. Listen to me. Death lost. It's the most boring film ever made. We already know the ending. His love conquers your brokenness. It's a done deal. Get with the program and see through the lens of story. I assure you, it will change your life. Let's make that our prayer. Go ahead and stand up. So Father Mark, when he showed up in Rome, he showed up on a Sunday and classes started on Monday, and all of his classes for seminary were in Italian. And he doesn't speak a lick of Italian. So he's in the first week of being in seminary. All he wants to do is be a priest. And it comes Friday and he finds himself in a Eucharistic chapel, absolutely weeping. Lord, I can't do this. All I want to do is be your priest. I don't know Italian. I can't do this. And he put his hands together like this. Put your hands together like this real quick. And he just started praying. And he was blessed with a vision. He was blessed with this vision of God's grace pouring down like rain. Pouring down. And he didn't want any of it to get dropped on the floor. So he cupped his hands like this. Cup your hands like this. And this is what he prayed. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. To be a sanctuary. Pure and holy. Pure and holy. Tried and true. Tried and true. With thanksgiving. With thanksgiving. I'll be a living. I'll be a living. Sanctuary, sanctuary for you. Do me a favor. Ladies, could you just stay standing? Gentlemen, could you sit down for just a second? Gentlemen, just give us a minute. Gentlemen, just sit for a minute. Just sit for a minute. Ladies, look at me. Ladies, eyes on me. Ladies, don't look at the screen. Look at me. Look at me. I'm a father of daughters. I get to talk to you for just a second. Ladies, look at me. Listen to me. You are daughters of a king, right? And you heard Sarah say this. You heard Sarah say to you, this is who you were made to be. Listen to me. Your heart, the feminine heart, It was made, it was built for compassion in a way that's totally unique to you. Listen to me. You are daughters of a king. And you were built, you were made to be exactly what you are. A daughter of a king with a heart for compassion. And listen to me. The world needs your heart. We need the feminine heart. We need you to express compassion to us in your unique way. Your face, your body was made exactly the way the King of Kings wanted it to be made. Share it. Share it with us. So just the ladies. Ladies, daughters of kings. Just the ladies. Let's pray. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Ladies, could you sit for a minute? Gentlemen, stand up. You knew it was coming. Get up. Men, look at me. Gentlemen, look at me. Don't look at the screens. Look at me. Look at me. Men, look at me. Gentlemen, you're sons of a king. And guess what? Your heart, the masculine heart, you know what it was made to do first and foremost? Serve its king. In fact, serve its king in a very unique way. Listen to me. You want to know what the Lord wants you to do? Listen to me. You need to learn to shut up. Men, men, look at me. Men, look at me. We'll get back to our sisters in a minute. Look at me, men. Your heart. We need your heart. Your body, your face, your heart. We need it. We need men who serve their king. And the only way you'll know what to do is to quiet yourself and to listen to him. Listen to your king. Give him silence every day. Just listen. And then you better buckle up. Because when you give your heart to your king, and he knows that you're genuine, and he knows that you're authentic, he will use it. And we need the masculine heart. So men, just the men, let's pray. Nice and loud, men. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Ladies, join us. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
One more time from the heart, nice and loud.
Lord, pray.